offering. They were the offering of God. They walked in fellowship with him every day. So this is my statement. You can choose to believe whatever you want to, but I honestly believe that in his mercy, that he said to them, you're living outside now because of sin, of the divine mercy that you had. But I'm going to teach you something that will restore mercy and favor back in your life. And I'm going to teach you how to give offerings to me. How to offer the first fruits of the ground, because Adam had to start planting a garden. He had to start working by the sweat of his brow to produce food for the family. And in the process of doing that, he began to bring the first fruits. Now, the first fruits of the garden. And you would say, how do you know that? Because that's what Abel did. Abel was taught, and that was the difference between Cain and Abel's offering, is that Abel brought the first fruits. He put God first, even outside of the fact. And if you could imagine how Abel must have felt and Cain must have felt when their dad told them what it was like to walk with God every day. So from the very foundation of this planet, and we all come from Adam and Eve, they were taught to give offerings. And there are some pastors and people who get so aggravated when a pastor or a leader talks about receiving an offering. Well, if we struggle with that, we really need to go back to who taught them how to give in the first place. It was God. And God favored Abel's offering over Cain's. And the Bible makes it very clear in Genesis, it was because of the first fruits, and he put God first in what he produced, and God favored him. It made Cain jealous, and to the point that he killed him. Now, I believe it's not the amount of what you give, it's always the attitude of what you give. So, me as a pastor, not only do I count it a privilege to teach you how to give, but it's also a spiritual obligation from God to teach you how to give. And that when we do this, we're not following some just trying to get people's money. Keep your money. Give it to somebody else. That's your attitude. No. You're giving to the Lord. And that was, gosh, 2,000 years before the law ever came, that the tithe was set up. And even before that was Melchizedek, who received tithe from Abraham, which was about 400 years before the law. Where did they learn to even give offerings? They learned it from Adam and Eve, who taught Cain and Abel, who Abel had taught his children and their children, and Adam and Eve had tons of kids in 900 years. I just want y'all to know that. And they knew the importance of giving offerings to the Lord. So I want you to see this. Let the Spirit of God lead you in your giving this year, that you're giving, and that the favor of the Holy Spirit is on our giving. Amen. He knows how to bring increase and blessings into our lives. So be encouraged. Don't ever just give it. You give it in thanksgiving to Almighty God. We're sowing offerings into his work, and when we sow into his work, we're sowing actually into him. Same way they gave it to the temple. Amen? Did y'all receive that this morning? Hallelujah. That's a scripture that'll keep you up at night, but it's a good one. All right, you guys ready to give? If you need an envelope for your giving, raise your hands. Ushers have envelopes for you. If you're making out a check, make it out to Impact Church. If you give online, what is it? Arkansas.com. Just go right on there. You go into Simple Give, and it's a real blessed way to give your tithes and offerings. Kim and I do it. We always make sure it's the first that we do. We give the first fruits, whatever comes to us, and then we honor God with it. All right, here's what we do. we're going to do the same thing that Abel did. We're going to worship him with our tithes and our offerings. Okay? Stand up with me. Hold up your gifts, however you give. I give through my iPhone, so I'm going to hold my phone up, and I am going to worship God. Father, we worship you. What a privilege and an honor it is to give. We thank you for that spirit of giving and release coming into this body, that everything we sow, tithes, offerings, given to the poor, given to missions, that God, you receive it, and that people are blessed. And this congregation is more blessed. We will be in abundance this year. Makes no difference what the economy does. Makes no difference what happens around this world. You are Jehovah Jireh. And let it be a revelation in our hearts as we sow our seed in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Okay, you can be seated. Go ahead and wait on the people while we're still attempting to get everything hooked back up here so that we can be on multimedia here. All right. Mike Croslow, stand up, please. Mike is from Uganda, Africa. How many years have we known each other?
Well, since 1982.
So what? How many years is that, guys? 38 years. When Mike and I were in our 20s, and I met him, he was already a missionary in Africa, and you've been in Africa for 40 years?
81.
Well, 81, so there you go, 39 years. Kim and I traveled in and out of Africa with him. We did Bible schools. We went all over Kenya and Uganda. And he is one of the dearest friends on this planet to me. And next week, Mike's going to be ministering here. So you do not want to miss it next week. And Mike, we're so blessed to have you in while you're here. All right. Yes, and here's... Yeah, okay. I don't remember that, but that's good. I used to go over and see these little kids. I mean, they were running around little squirts, but we had so much fun in Africa ministering to the people. Mike's got spiritual sons and daughters all over Africa, I'm telling you. Credible man of God, you will be absolutely blessed. Father, right now we thank you so much for the Word. The Word is alive. It is powerful. And I thank you, Holy Spirit, that we just release the spirit of revelation in this place. You're on the inside of every believer. And I thank you, Father, for just ministering through us and to us today. But more than anything, that you open the hearts of our understanding and give us revelation. And Father, we pray for every person that's lost, that does not know Jesus as their Lord. Holy Spirit, convict them, open their eyes to see the darkness in their life, and let them make Jesus the Lord of their lives. And everyone watching on Facebook and other areas, we just pray for them, God, that you use this to minister life in Jesus' name. I have really, over the last few months, just over and over, in my own heart, you know, heard the word, different words, transformation, reformation, and it all kind of came together last week. And as I was studying some things that the Apostle Paul had written about the last days, also that Peter had mentioned about the last days. And the last days, those words are throughout the New Testament. Jesus talked about it. So the apostles talked about it. There are things that are going to happen in the last days. Now, how many of you understand the listing in the last days? It sounds pretty rough. Perilous times and all this. But within all that, there is also going to be incredible spiritual awakening. Where sin abounds, grace does what? Much more abounds. And as I was looking last week in the actual book of Revelation, Notice it's called the Book of Revelation. It is not called the Book of Revelations. It's not plural, it's singular. And the word revelation there is the unveiling of Christ. Wow. We're going to come, and we're moving into it now, where that Christ in us is going to be unveiled. Do we have one of those prayer cloths around here? Is there one over there underneath somebody's feet? If we do, you got one? Can I have one if we have one over there? Okay. I know we used to have some around here. If someone knows where one is, just get me one. But if not, let me just say this. Jennifer, can I borrow one of your flags? Give me that blue one back there. Thank you so much. Now, that'll represent a very good veil. Oh, here we go. Look at that right in front of us. We didn't know it. Okay, this will be fine. Thank you. The unveiling of Christ. And when we all were lost, this is exactly the way we looked. We were veiled. The gospel was veiled to us. When we got born again, that veil was taken off. Now, what does that actually mean? It means the eyes of your understanding became enlightened to Christ. You know what you literally saw when you were veiled in darkness? Guess what you saw? You saw your darkness. You saw the place of your soul and that your spirit was without Christ. But the minute you confessed and made Jesus the Lord of your life, the veil was totally lifted. And all of a sudden, your spirit became alive and one with God. Now, here's the thing. The spirit got born again. But how many of you discovered your thinking did not get born again? Your emotions didn't get born again. Your will didn't get born again. But your spirit got completely enlightened. And I'm going to show you the difference between spirit, soul, and body. But the soul and the body are not born again. The soul, which is I will, I feel, I think, it's my emotions. And the way I see spirit, soul, and body is this right here. You've got spirit, soul, and body. And if you could draw a heart, and your soul, I feel, I will, I think. If you could draw a heart around the soul, that is the real you. That's the heart. That is what has to be born again is the heart. The heart has to change. You have to take on a new heart, and that new heart is what happens in the spirit. The spirit's not the heart. Because Jesus said, out of the heart proceeds all kind of evils and everything, and out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. The heart with the soul, the mind, everything has to be transformed. Now, here's what I'm going to do. I'm just going to walk us through 2 Corinthians chapter 3, starting at verse 7. We're going to walk it right through the Passion Translation. But I want you to really understand what God is wanting to do in your life this year. He is wanting to move the darkness out of our emotions, out of our will, and especially out of the way we think. Because can I tell you something? Do you know that you can be a born-again Christian, but in your emotions and in your mind, in your thinking, you can live just like this. And you can live your world totally veiled because you do not change the way you think. And you do not change, and you live out of your emotions. Well, Pastor Terry, Dad had an anger problem. My grandfather had an anger problem. My whole family tree had an angry problem. The root system was wicked, and bless God, that's why I'm angry. That does not work with Jesus. Well, I searched my family tree. Well, honey, maybe you need to dig that puppy up. Because in Christ, we start a whole new family tree. And the soul, the emotions, the personality, who we are, has to conform to the spirit. And it's got to understand your true identity is not whether you're a sanguine, whether you're what, phlegmatic, what's the next ones? Choleric, or whatever. All these personalities, do y'all know the billions of dollars that are spent every year on trying to find out who we are? I'm just trying to decide who I am. I'm going and I'm talking to everybody just to find out what is wrong with me. Who am I? Identity is crazy right now. And Jesus is standing over here telling us through the Word of God who we are. Who we really are. And that our identification is in our spirit and our oneness with God. It is not the roots of the Nance family. Just because my twin brother acts like me, you know, that's just something that comes natural because we're twins. But it doesn't give me excuse to say, well, if he can do it, I can do it. No. Everything comes back to his word and the revealing of our identification and the unveiling of Christ and who we are. We're never going to be the witness that we want to be. We're never going to be the person we want to be. We're never going to come to the place until we understand who we are in Christ and what grace has already provided for us in the finished work of Jesus Christ. Faith is not me believing for something in the future. Faith is me accepting and receiving what grace has already provided for me in the finished work of Jesus Christ. And the more we look at who we are in the Word of God and the mirror of who Christ is and who is really living in here, this is the real you. This is not the real you. Everybody got this? Hey, let me smile. I'll make sure I'm smiling while I preach this. Because everything that has happened in me in my time of 2 months of solitude, I want you to know something. When I was in Georgia, August and September, just me and this right here. And the Spirit of the Lord said to me, you're not picking up a book. You're not reading somebody else's book. You're going to read this book. And you're not reading the Old Testament. Nope. You're going to stay in the New Testament, Terry. And for all the 2 months, do you know what? Every morning or at 2 o'clock in the morning, I had a place all by myself. Me and the Bible, but did you know that Jesus visited me every morning? Every morning. Oh, Pastor, whoo, the Lord visited you? You mean to tell me he appeared to you? Do you mean to tell me you saw angels? You saw all this? No, no. You know, he visited me right here. Right here. You cannot separate him and his word. And we live, and I want everybody to hear me. I'm going to be very careful how I say this. But we're in this thing, or this season, that we want to follow unctions. Well, I feel an unction of the Holy Spirit. And or I'm looking for a vision, or I want to see angels, and I'm going to be very scriptural, very honest, but there's nowhere in the Bible that the Bible teaches us to pray to see angels. Nowhere. Matter of fact, Paul warns us about the worship of angels. Well, Pastor Terry, what about a Bible leaking oil? Now, there are just some things that are mysteries. I've studied revival church history for years, and there are just some really strange things that happen. They're unexplainable. The only scripture in the Bible that you can look at is the scripture that says they prayed and asked for signs and wonders, and a sign is what makes you wonder. And there are, I will say, some strange things. But here's what I want you to listen to me. And there is a Bible that actually leaks oil down in, it's either in Georgia or Alabama. And people have flocked, I know, and there's nothing wrong with that. If I had an opportunity, I'd go see it. But here's the truth. The oil coming out of that Bible is not any more anointed than this oil right here. It is not the oil that heals you. It is the prayer of faith that heals you. I could use 10 W-40 on you, and if you had faith, you could get your healing. Well, Pastor Terry, before you can even take communion, you got to have grape juice. Well, Jesus didn't use grape juice. Do y'all know that? No, he drank wine. Oh, heavens, let's all grab a pole. Now, let's get the legalism out. Do you know that the anointing of God, if you said a Coca-Cola, and I'm telling you, a piece of Panera Bread, and that's what you had, or you had a bagel, and you sat there and said, I don't have anything else, but Father, that is communion. I'm going to receive this as the blood and as the bread. Did you know the Holy Ghost will bless that? It is not the legalistic stuff. It is understanding the relationship with the Father that you have and the transformation that he wants to take place in your life, that our root system is no longer buried where we come from, but it is buried in the fact that we are sons and daughters of the Almighty God. That is who we are. My citizenship is not the United States of America. My citizenship is the sonship of a heavenly realm. God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Ghost. And my name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. And then when that becomes such a reality in you, then you quit squabbling and all trying to discover why you think and you react the way that you are, and you begin to get in Jesus' word and begin to discover the real you. And the real you rises up, your mind becomes transformed and reformed to who you really are, and revelation comes that changes your life, that puts to dominate. It dominates anxiety. It dominates fear. It dominates the doubt. It dominates being born on the wrong side of the tracks. It dominates the family tree. It breaks it because you understand your identity is in Christ. The Apostle Peter and these guys, they got blasted with the Holy Ghost. Did you know that they didn't make the upper room a shrine? You never hear another word about it. The next night, they weren't, everybody get together. Woo, we, tongues of fire, the glory of God. Let's all get there. Everybody crowding in the upper room. Let's get up in the upper room. No, they didn't do that. You know what they did? Peter goes to the gate, beautiful, and said, silver and gold I don't have, but what I got on the inside of me, you get ready, I'm about to give. So it didn't come from above, it came from within. Now, I'm laying a foundation, but I want everyone to hear my heart, because it is the Bible which is the absolute authority that we are accountable to. This is not just a book. It is the living Word of God, written personally by the Holy Spirit. That is why, that's where people get off. Well, the Holy Spirit told me to do this. Is that right? Give me chapter and give me verse. Well, I just know what I feel. No. We did Bible schools all over, and we did a Bible school in Iceland. Very interesting place. And I went to Iceland, and I talked to all the students. And one of the problems that we had with a lot of the students was, well, the Holy Ghost is telling me to do this. No. And one of the individuals said this. Well, I know it is wrong for me to sleep with my boyfriend, but the Holy Spirit said it was okay. And we said, sorry, but no. No, why? Because this is absolute truth. This is the Holy Spirit. I'm not led by some unction. I'm led by the Spirit, who always will confirm it through His Word. So what I'm saying to you, and I know it's what the Lord did in my life, is to get back into the Word. Now let's move on here. Let's get into 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse number 7. I'm reading it out of the passage, the Passion Translation. Here we go. Even the ministry that was characterized by chiseled letters on stone tablets came from a dazzling measure of glory, though it preceded death. You got to say, give me a break. What do you mean? The Ten Commandments in stone, written in the hand of God, and as dazzling as it was, it produced death? How does that produce death? Because at that time, they were not born again. The law was given to reveal to them that they needed a Savior. There was 400 and something laws. You couldn't even fulfill it. You couldn't even walk it out. That is why the law was given, because it was showing them that there was going to come a Savior who was going to fulfill the law, give us grace, that the law of God is not something that we legally follow, but the law of God is written on our hearts, to our relationship with God Himself. So that was incredible. It was incredible glory. The Israelites couldn't bear to even gaze on the glowing face of Moses because of the radiant splendor shining from his countenance, a glory destined to fade away. The glory so shone on Moses' face that the people couldn't even look at him. They had to put a veil over him because he was too bright to look at. That is a man in the very actual presence of God Himself who said, show me your glory. And God says, well, you want to see my glory? I'm going to show you my goodness, because my goodness is my glory. And God walked before him, put him in a cleft of a rock, and said, you cannot look on my face and live. No human flesh can look at the face of God and live. You're not made for it. Your spirit can when you're in heaven, but you can't. And so he puts him, so he sees the backside of God. God moved his hand, and he actually saw, and his face lit up like a Christmas tree. Well, I think ours would too. So it comes down, but what the Bible's making very clear and Paul's making clear is this glory is going to fade. Now, charismatic Christians, I know we cry for this, oh God, I just want to see your glory. I just want to see your glory. Oh, God, give me your glory. Oh, and what is the glory of God? You ever asked yourself that? Well, Pastor Terry, the glory of God, come on. The glory of God is when gold dust is just blowing through the auditorium. No. Now, that may be a manifestation of the, and again, I'm not mocking, please, everybody, I am not mocking any of this. This is real. This stuff happens. There are things you'll never be able to explain. But in the book of Acts, they never saw glory. They never saw gold dust. They never saw feathers. They never saw jewels being manifest. There's a lot of things they didn't see that we have seen and church history records. How many of you even know where the Quakers came from? The Quakers came out of revival. The power of God would so fall on the Quakers that women, they wore their hair way, I'm up to the sky almost, and they'd start shaking, they'd start quaking, and the hair would fall down. They would quake so hard that in church history in the 1800s, it said it sounded like a whip being popped. Now, that's some shaking going on. That's Elvis doing a whole lot of shaking going on. And yet, there it is. It happened. It happened. But you cannot put your faith in the shaking. You cannot follow gold dust. You can't follow a leaking Bible. You can't follow that. Why? Because you're looking for something in the natural that is only going to take place in the spirit. God is a spirit. Now, are those things cool? Will they touch you? Absolutely. But you know what grieves me so much? I've been through the Word of Faith movement. Wonderful. It had its shortcomings, but it taught us how to get in the Bible. Then in the 90s, mid-90s, then the Brownsville revival and the moving of the Spirit was incredible. I spent one time 2 hours. When I mean couldn't get up, I couldn't get up. And the Holy Spirit just broke stuff out of me. It was incredible. Phenomenal. And I had someone tell me, Pastor Terry, I've been on the floor 66 times. Cool. That's great. But in less than 3 months, they were divorced. So what's missing? Can I tell everybody what's missing? This right here that's missing. And because we're chasing something. Well, I need a fresh touch from God. Do you know you got so much touch already on the inside of you, you need to start releasing what you got. It is. I was so broken several months ago, and I mean, I was having my pity party. Anybody ever have a pity party? That's when only one person shows up. I was bawling and squalling, laying in the floor. Oh, God, give me peace. You got to give me peace. I don't have understanding. Give me peace. And after about, I don't know, a good hour of that, just bawling, squalling, beating the floor, but and all of a sudden, the Spirit of God speaks to me and says, would you stop that? And I set up my, and I know when the Holy Spirit speaks to me. He said, just stop it. He said, you've been begging me for peace. What did I tell you in my word? I said, Jesus, you said, not only do I give you peace, I give you my peace. He said, well, did I give it or not? And then I went around repenting the rest of the time. You know, God, forgive me. Lord, forgive me. I didn't mean to say that. I get it. I get what you're saying. He said, Terry, you're fighting for something I've already given you. It's already done. It's in you. I either gave it to you or I didn't. The peace of God that passes all understanding rules your heart. But Jesus told his apostles in John, I believe it's chapter 15. Peace, I leave with you. But then he clarified it. Peace, my peace, I give to you. So, the glory Well, what in the world is the glory? I'm so glad you asked. John chapter 17, verse 22 through 23. I have given them the glory you gave me. Everybody read that with me. I have given them the glory you gave me. Now leave it up there. I have given. Wait a minute. I'm not going to give. I have given them the glory you gave me. So they may be one as we are one. I in them and you are in me. That they may experience such perfect unity that the world will know that you sent me, oh, get this, and that you love them as much as you love me. Tim, your twin boys, which one do you love the most? And why did you say that? Because he's here. That absolutely, that's a smart dad. That is really smart. You can't. You absolutely cannot say that. You would crucify yourself. Here's the point. If Jesus were standing here, he appeared right here, and it'd be really cool if he did. And he can if he decides to. That's great. But that's the sovereignty of him. That's his sovereignty. I don't have to see Jesus. It's not necessary. Blessed are those who have never seen and believed. More blessed. Now, if he walks in here and stood right here, and I took Tim and Tim and I stood beside each other. And we asked Jesus, or we asked the Father. We asked the Father, Father, here's Jesus, Tim, and Terry. Which one do you love the most? And the Father says, neither. I love them all the same. I pray that you'll take that scripture home with you today. I pray that you'll go to bed tonight and you'll read that scripture. Your Father loves you as much as he loves Jesus. Man. Man, oh man. Wow. Well, Tim may have read the Bible more than me today. So surely God loves Tim more than he loves me, because I only had 5 minutes. No. It's not based on works. It's all based on grace. Well, I know, Pastor, you're a pastor, so God truly loves you more than he loves the rest of you. Uh-uh. Not based on office, based on heart, and based on grace. There's nothing I can do to make him love me any more than he already does. Impossible. It's impossible. All I need to do is this right here. Father, I believe it, I receive it, and now I release it into my soul that my Father loves me as much as he loves you. Amen, amen. That. The soul and the spirit. The glory. All right. Wow. Glory. The glory is not some cloud floating around. The glory of the Father, the glory of Jesus, is the kingly majesty which belongs to him as supreme ruler, the majesty in the sense of absolute, everybody say absolute, perfect. Question. How do you even understand? God of peace make you holy in every way and make your whole spirit and soul and body be kept blameless until our Lord Jesus Christ comes again. You'll never understand the revelation of glory and who you are until you understand spirit, soul, and body. Philip, come up here. Stand with me right here. Tim, you come up here and you stand right beside me. Man is a three-part being. Here's spirit, I'm soul, and here's body. The absolute perfection of God came into your spirit when you got born again. Jesus himself, the complete deity of God, moved inside this spirit. Do you know when you got born again, a third of you has already been glorified? Well, what I need is more of God. How do you get more of him? You can't get more of him. It's impossible to get more of him. This guy already has eternal life. This part of your being has already been glorified. It's totally, completely perfect. Now, I'm going to make this as simple can be. You know where the problem lies? This guy right here. So the soul is going to line up with one of the two. Okay, I'm going to show you. Tim, let's walk over here. Two against one wins. There it is. But let's bring it back. Stand right here. Two against one wins. That is as simple as life gets, and as simple as it is. Now, you guys can be seated. Thank you. But I want to say this. I'm going to be very, very careful with this. I fully understand the abuse and the brokenness of the soul. And what people have gone through. I have counseled people that I wanted to fall on my face and bawl with them and cry for the sexual abuse, the verbal abuse, and everything they have gone through in their soul and the hurt. And many Christian people, they need deliverance, they need counseling, they need help. But if you're not careful, you'll spend all your time just chasing your tail until you begin to realize who you really are. And let, because here it is, the thing is, this is what transforms the soul to the spirit, is the word. It's the word. Every day since August, every day, I spend my time with the Lord and the Bible. And the thing that has changed mine and Kim's marriage to a place it's never been before, as we don't walk out of the door without reading a chapter of the Bible together. We pray, first of all, for our elders. Then we pray for our staff. Then we pray for the body of Impact. And then we pray for our children. For the last, since November. And we don't miss a day. And we made a commitment to that. Why? Because I know that when Kim and I are operating in unity, there isn't anything we can't do for the kingdom of God. And the marriage is likened to Christ and his church. So that's a word for the married folks in this place. But when you begin to understand, Jesus already said, the glory that you gave me, I get it. So here's what I want everybody to do. Quit looking for the glory. Start releasing the glory that's in you. Peter said, what I have, I give you. What's in me? So everything in the Old Testament came from above. The Spirit of the Lord came upon Samuel. The Spirit of the Lord came upon Daniel. The Spirit of the Lord came upon David. The Spirit of the Lord came upon Samson, Jephthah. All of, the Spirit of God came on. All came from above. But new covenant believers, it all comes from within. Oh, I'll get to it next week or the week after. Not next week because Mike's preaching, but I'll get to it later on. And I just love this. It just blessed my socks off. And in John chapter 7 where Jesus, only twice is it ever recorded in the New Testament Jesus ever shouted. Now this made him shout. And he stood up to the crowds and he believeth in me, let him come and drink first rivers of living water. Woo! Now that will preach. Out of your belly. It isn't going to come from above. It's going to come from within. Because why? It's already there. It is in your spirit, rivers of living water, life, not anxiety, not grief, not oppression, not depression, but peace, love, joy, the goodness of God, the mercy of God. It's all in you. And the day that we accept who we are, instead of crying for peace and begging for freedom, we'll begin to say, thank you, Father. I receive the finished work of Jesus Christ. I am applying my faith to what grace has already provided. And I receive it in my family. I don't have to be poor anymore. You are Jehovah Jireh. Prosperity's in me. Grace is in me. Healing's in me. And I release it into my body. And I receive it. No, my body is not going to stay with diabetes in the name of Jesus. The life of God, the healing of God is flowing up out of my spirit into my body. Restoring my health. Renewing my mind. Refreshing my spirit. Shikamoshai. Hallelujah. It is what's already provided in grace. Let's read it so we can finish it. Verse 8. Yet how much more radiant is the new and glorious ministry of the Spirit that shines. Notice, not doesn't shine upon us, but shines from us. Do y'all see that? The ministry of the Spirit in me, it isn't coming on me, it's shining from me. For if the former ministry of condemnation was ushered with such a measure of glory, how much more does the ministry that imparts righteousness far excel in glory? Righteousness is not a difficult term. Righteousness simply means you are now born of God and you are seated in heavenly places in Christ. And you have right standing before the Father to run in there and call him Abba, Daddy, climb up in his lap, hug him, love him. And she just squeezes her tail in into my chair, just snuggled. And Lily, my puppy dog who loves me, has to leave because McKenna has taken her place. But do you think I mind that? She gives me a big hug and says, Daddy, I love you so much. And you know what you want to do? What do you want? But she didn't do it to ask of anything. She did it. Why? Relationship. My kids all have a key to my house. I don't have a key to any of theirs. They didn't give me a key, but they got a key to all my stuff. Man, McKenna left the other day, moved out. I said, hallelujah, we're free again. Because my shaving cream's gone, my razors are gone. She goes into my bathroom, cleans out my toothpaste. At least she doesn't take my toothbrush, but she cleans all my stuff out. I go in, where's my shaving cream? Where are my razors? And they're upstairs. Why? Because she's a Nance, and she takes full advantage of it. And then she laughs. And I have to go buy new. And I buy, you know, when she comes, I always buy her stuff. So here, this is yours. Keep that. And it's all done in fun. We laugh. But isn't that the truth? Isn't that what you do with your kids, Philip, Sherry? Isn't that the truth? And they just act like they own the place. Totally. Get up when they want to, eat your food. She called me the other day, hey, Dad, I found a brand new restaurant. Hey, can you come over and take me out to eat? And I said, are you buying? She goes, well, I guess I'll eat at home. Oh, this is so good. What once was glorious no longer holds any glory. It's gone. Old Testament glory is history. Because of the increasing greater glory that has replaced it. The fading ministry came with a portion of glory. But now we embrace the unfading ministry of a permanent impartation of glory. Majesty. T.L. Osborne did something one day and floored everybody. He stood up, if you ever knew his ministry, and he said, everybody look at me. How many of you are looking for Jesus? And everybody raised their hand, and he went just like this. And just stood there. Everybody, their mouth was hanging open. He said, you are looking at Jesus. Guess who I'm looking at? Guess what happened on the day of Pentecost? What made the devil so mad? He crucified Jesus, and then all of a sudden he got 120 little Jesuses running around. Oh, wow. So then, we'll finish this up. This is amazing hope living in us. So we step out in what? Freedom and boldness to speak the truth. We're not like Moses, who used a veil to hide the glory to keep the Israelites from staring at him as it faded away. Their minds were closed and hardened, for even to this day, that same veil comes over their minds when they hear the words of the former covenant. He's referring to the Jewish people. The veil has not yet been lifted from them, for it is only eliminated when one is joined to the Messiah. So until now, whenever the Old Testament is being read, the same blinding comes over their hearts. But the moment one turns to the Lord with an open heart, the veil is lifted and they can see. Now, the Lord I'm referring to is the Holy Spirit. And wherever the Lord is, there is freedom. Freedom! Freedom. You are free. You're not struggling trying to get free. Your spirit is free. That is the real you. There is no bondage. There is no addiction. There is no depression. None of that in your spirit. So what we need to do is start acting like our spirit acts. Begin to rejoice in the soul. Get in the Word. Let your mind be renewed to these things, that you are transformed until two against one wins. Hallelujah, Pastor Terry. That is great preaching. That is. But the truth of it is, it's nothing but the Bible. So here we go. We'll close it right here. Man, we can all draw close to Him with the veil removed from our faces. And with no veil, we all become like mirrors who brightly reflect the glory of the Lord Jesus. We are being transfigured into His very image as we move from one brighter level of glory. So where's that glory? In you, to another. And this glorious transformation comes from the Lord, who is the Spirit. What is the mirror? The mirror is the Word. When you look at yourself in the Word and you walk away, Satan tells you you're still flawed. And there's nothing wrong with admitting I am flawed. But let me tell you what happens. I keep looking at that mirror, and the more I look, the more what's in me starts coming out. Rivers. Rivers of revelation of the Spirit. Rivers of who I am in Christ. And one of these days, and what I'm doing, I am growing in the Word of God. And one day I look, and me and Jesus are walking together by the power of the Holy Spirit. You know, revival is in you. Spiritual awakening is in you. Oh, I need God to come down on me, shake me like a tree, and then just throw me out into the harvest. No. It ain't going to happen that way. No. When you begin, the Bible tells you, stay filled with the Spirit by singing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart. When you start thanking the Lord for what He's already done. Father, I just worship You. I thank You for who I am. I will not listen to the lies of the devil anymore. I will not let him tell me that I can't make it, that I'm a product of my father, or I'm a product of this, or abuse, that abuse has to control me. No. In the name of Jesus, whatever it takes, you get good people around you. You get good Christians around you, but you keep your life in that Word until your soul, your emotions, everything is starting to line up with your spirit. Faith is simply receiving what God has already provided by grace. It's the finished work of Jesus. It's who you really are. That's your true identity. That is what changes everything. Stand up with me. Hallelujah. Oh, thank You, Lord. Thank You, Lord Jesus. Thank You, Lord Jesus. I want to say something. Are we still? I want to say something to everyone watching on social media right now. If you do not know Jesus as your Lord and personal Savior, you're veiled. Jesus wants to reveal Himself to you. Jesus wants to take the veil off your face so that you see Him. And you say, well, what do I need to do? All you need to do is say, Jesus, come into my heart. Change my life. I believe that God raised You from the dead. Believe it with your heart. It takes more than confession out of your mouth. but honestly, with your heart, ask him to come into your life, and he will come right now, and he will change you forever. Be healed, be delivered in the name of Jesus. Stand up and take your rightful place in the Lord. Some of you, you've allowed the enemy to come in through maybe sin, maybe hurt, depression, or whatever. Hey, God's mercy, you belong in his living room. Go right into his living room of grace and receive the glory of the Lord and be delivered. Lift up your hands and start thanking him for grace and peace over your life. Father, I pray for everyone watching on social media. In the name of Jesus, I release your power and your love to go into their lives. Change them right now in Jesus' name. Amen. Mark, bring the lights down. I want our elders to come.